It's good to see you all on this fine Sunday morning. Start off, we just have a couple of announcements. Would it be easier if I just use that?
You can't go in front of the speakers. You
can't go in front.
You're being leashed.
I'm learning. If you guys notice, we have an improved setup here. So thank you, Brian and Jen, for this improved setup this morning. So the first announcement that we have is the elders and I, we met earlier this week to talk about our future plans. And the tentative plan, as long as there's no other major outbreak or any other monumental event taking place, we will tentatively plan on doing this, an outdoor service, for the rest of the Sundays of the month of June. And then July 5th, the first Sunday in July, we will meet inside. We will have a number of precautions to keep you guys all safe and healthy. Before then, we'll talk about more of the details as far as precautions we are taking. But so you guys are all aware, we'll plan on doing this for the rest of the month of June. And then in July, we can take advantage of our beautiful sanctuary in there. Starting next Sunday from 9:45 a.m. to 10:15 a.m., so just a half hour session right before our service, John is going to be leading a little devotional time. I don't see John out there. I know he's here. He's way there in the back. John is going to be leading a Rise and Shine devotional in the morning, and that's from 9:45 to 10:15. And we'll plan to do that for the time being. John, do you know what you're talking about yet or no?
No,
all right. He's going to prayerfully consider it, and I look forward to it. So I'd encourage you guys all to come out and join us 9:45 next Sunday, and we'll meet in the picnic shelter over there. And so we'll get done. Plenty of time for you to find your spot over here, and I look forward to that. I always love hearing what John has to say. And the last announcement that I have, announced it last week, but we are meeting our youth group in person. We had our first in-person meeting last Wednesday. It went great. It's for any youth, 6th grade on up, and we meet 7 to 8 p.m. Wednesday evenings. We had Evelyn graduated to our youth group, and so it was a joy to have Evelyn join us. And so if anybody else is interested, 7 to 8 Wednesday evenings, we meet in the youth room, in the basement, in the church. I'd love to see any of you guys there. And so those are all the announcements that we have this morning. So I'll go ahead and I will open up with a word of prayer. So if you'll bow with me. Father God, I just thank you for this day. Father, I thank you for the bright sunny day again. Father, I just pray that you are blessed, that you are given all of the glory and the honor in this service this morning. Father, I just pray that you be with all the services taking place around this country and in the nation. And Father, I just pray that we do this all for you and for your sake. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
First of all, I'm going to apologize ahead of time for anything you're about to hear from me. This is not my instrument of choice. This is not what I'm comfortable with, but this is what we're going with right now. Second of all, you guys should all have a lyric sheet. Does anybody need one? Y'all good? How did you get missed? Do you have any more, Ben? Where are they? Are they way up there? Cheryl. Oh, okay, never mind. She's Sharon. Thank you. Saved us a trip up the hill. All right. So on that lyric sheet, you should have lyrics and an order of service. And follow along the best that you can. I put the choruses that we repeat in bold so that you can go back to the chorus easily in each song. But we're going to start out with Song of My Soul.
There's a song in my soul, and I feel it stirring in me. This I know for sure, that your love is like a flood, and your mercy never ending. I give my song to you. There's a joy in my soul, and it rises like the morning. Your grace is enough, and your promise never breaks.
your sheet. I stand here.
My desperate feet come running to you from shaky ground. Facing defeat, I am holding on to your promise now. Raise me up on eagle's wings, give my soul your bigger dreams.
We have a time to share any prayer requests or praises that we have. So if anybody has any prayer requests or praises that you'd like to share, now is the time to do so. Yes, Margie?
Last week I said we found a spot on Brett's lungs. Well, apparently Dr. Monjot says there's two, but he's more concerned about his sleep apnea. So that tells me not to worry too much about the lungs.
Yeah.
So we're just praying that
I still need him, though, to sleep.
Yeah, they're kind of important, huh?
Yeah, well, you know.
I can deal with sleep apnea.
Yeah, she's been living next to a freight train our whole married life.
So just keep us in your prayers.
Absolutely.
And hope Margie goes deaf.
Russ about Elois.
Yes, if Russ, would you like to share?
Well, I talked to her this morning. She's
feeling much better, but nothing, no new answers or nothing resolved. She's feeling better, but we still have to do the test. I guess they just want you to lay there for a weekend and charge you $1,000 a day.
Yeah.
As for those of you guys who are unaware, Alois went in Friday night, right, into the hospital for an irregular heartbeat. And so she is still there. So remember Alois in your prayers. And Russ as well, as he's not able to be with Alois during this time because of the restrictions due to the coronavirus.
Turn
the wind off.
Look at right on that.
Yes, Dave?
Yesterday, Jessica got to do her one-of-a-kind graduation and got the walk.
Yay!
With your media family there, and it was a good day.
Good. Somehow you made it, Jesse. We don't know how, but somehow you made it. Well, very good. That is a praise indeed. Are there any other prayer requests or praises at this time?
Just a praise. I got to see my friend Ron.
Yes.
Hi Roman.
Yes, we all love you, Roman, and we'll remember you all in our prayers.
Thank you.
Yeah, praise.
Yes.
I'm just glad to be here with you all. I'm Jamie's mom. Yay. Corey. Had a safe trip in.
Yes, absolutely. Well, very good. If there are no other prayer requests or praises, we'll go ahead and we will turn to the Lord in prayer. So if you'll bow with me. Father God, I thank you for this beautiful weather. Father, I thank you for letting us all gather together as your church. Father, this time, I just pray that you be with Alois and the procedures going on there. And I just pray that the doctors can find some answers, some good answers. Father, I pray that you be with Brett and the two spots that were found on his lungs, as well as the sleep apnea. And I just pray that that can all be resolved rather easily. Father, I thank you for the praises in life, such as graduation. I thank you for bringing Jessie into all of our lives and just the blessing that she is and that she was able to have a graduation of some sort. And so I thank you for that. Father, I thank you for bringing Roman here as well. And I just pray that you cover his family with love and comfort. And we're just joyous to have him here with all of us. And I just thank you for the beautiful gift of your son, the beautiful gift of eternal life, which was only made possible through your son. And so I just pray that you be with us in this hour. I pray that you give me the words to speak. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Normally at this time we would take up offering, giving back to God what was already his and he's let us make use of. But we won't be doing that. If you didn't notice, there is a box for offering up on the table behind us, and you can leave your offering in there as you head out if you haven't already done so. So we're going to continue with our worship service singing praises.
The name that's
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
It is good to see you all on this fine Sunday morning. It's great to gather together again as the body of Christ, as the family of God. Last week we talked about how we are the church, and that is absolutely the truth. We are the church. It's not about the billion, but it's about us, the people, and we are the church. And it's good to be back together as God's church to worship with all of you guys. So when I was growing up, I was a rather timid kid who was real nice to everyone, and nobody ever really had much of a problem with me. I was real easygoing, and I just got along with just about everybody that came away because I was real timid, I was real easygoing, and I didn't really like confrontations much going up, so I just went with the flow. Nobody really had a dislike for me, and I was just easygoing, timid little kid, Kyle. If you didn't know, growing up, I still am short, but I grew a good bit in high school and college. I used to be like the shortest kid in my grade. So I was just a short little Kyle that everybody liked and adored. But that all would change when I would step onto a basketball court or a baseball field or soccer field. And all of a sudden, my timid, easygoing self went away, and I would bring a tenacity and an anger. I made a number of enemies at my time in Little League baseball, my time in middle school track or basketball, and my many years of playing soccer. I made a number of different enemies as I was no longer my shy, timid little self, but I was extremely, and I still am competitive, but I was extremely competitive, and I still am to this day. Jamie frequently asked me, why does everything always have to be a competition with you? I don't know, but that's just the way it is. It's gotta be. And I would bring that tenacity, that competitiveness when I would even play with my friends, and I immediately think of Luke Ella, who is now the son-in-law of John and Neola Tolis. And we've been best friends for about 10 years now, but you would never, ever, ever guess that if you saw us competing against each other in a game of basketball or volleyball, spikeball, frisbee, whatever it be, because we are both very competitive, and all of a sudden we would become enemies. We are no longer friends. We were enemies when we were on opposing teams and whatever sport we may be playing. Is anybody else like this, where you can be real nice in general, but then when it comes to competition, you make yourself a number of enemies?
It's all you.
Sylvia, yes, me and you, Sylvia, and Katie, yes. Watch out if you ever competed against me, Sylvia, or Katie. Watch out. You're our enemy. We don't play nice. We're a competitive bunch here. But I find that can be the truth oftentimes when people are playing sports. So you may be friends with someone, but all of a sudden, when you are competing with one another, all of a sudden your friendship just goes out the window. I recently just heard a NBA player talking about how when they get on the court, they talk trash to one another, but when they get off the court, they're best of buds, and they're all part of one brotherhood that they all have. And so we can often find ourselves having enemies from time to time and whatever we may be doing. And today we're going to be talking about our enemies, a topic you may not hear talked about too much, and dealing with our enemies. But before we dig into the scripture this morning and talk about our enemies, I think it would be beneficial for us this morning to define what an enemy is. An enemy is, by definition, a person who is actively opposed or hostile to something or someone. So basically, by definition, an enemy is someone who is opposed to what you do, someone who is opposed to your will, someone who is opposed to your objective, goal, or will being done. So an enemy is someone who is opposed to you. And so if you're playing basketball or football or baseball or soccer, whatever it may be, it is your objective to score more points than the other team. And the other team is actively opposing your objective as they are trying to score more points than you. So by definition, the opposing team is your enemy when you are playing a game of basketball or soccer or football or whatever it may be. By definition, your opposing team is your enemy. Now that may seem strange to hear coming from your pastor that the opposing team in a game of football, baseball, or basketball is your enemy, because aren't we all supposed to be friendly to one another? Aren't we all supposed to be friends? But I think it's only strange that I call the opposing teams our enemies because of the way our society and culture and the way our human nature tell us to treat our enemies. Our culture, our society, our own human nature tell us to retaliate our enemies. When an enemy comes our way, it tells us to get back at them, to seek vengeance. And that's probably all of our initial reaction when we're confronted by an enemy, by someone who opposes us, by someone who opposes our objective or our will or our goal that we have set. And so that's why I think it may sound strange for me to call people our enemies. If I had to guess, I would say that we all have enemies in our life. And that's okay. In fact, that may actually be a good thing that we have some enemies in our life. That may mean that you're accomplishing some good stuff in your life if you have some enemies. Enemies. And so, yeah, it may be strange for me to say that we have enemies, but I think it's because the way our society and culture tell us to treat our enemies. But this morning, I want to take a look at God's Word and see how we are supposed to treat and interact with our enemies. What does the Bible have to say? And more specifically, what does Jesus have to say about this topic of treating our enemies and interacting with our enemies? So if you have your Bibles, you can open up to the book of Luke. We'll be looking at the book of Luke, and we'll be spending our time in Luke chapter 6. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the four Gospels. So the third Gospel there, third book of the New Testament, Luke. And we'll be reading from verses 27 through 36. And the wind is causing me issues over here. So here in chapter 6 of Luke, this is Jesus is talking. This is the Sermon on the Mount, the part that we'll be reading from today in Luke chapter 6, verses 27 through 36. And so Jesus, he is in front of a large group and he is delivering a sermon. You know, it probably looked pretty similar to what we are doing here. Just add probably hundreds and thousands of people in attendance. And so it's very similar to what we're doing here. Jesus is preaching in front of a large group of people. And here, as Jesus is preaching to this large group of people, Jesus tells this group of people how we are to interact with our enemies. And Jesus says in verse 27 of chapter 6, he says, "But I say to you who hear, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who abuse you. To one who strikes you on the cheek, offer the other also. And from one who takes away your cloak, do not withhold your tunic either. Give to everyone who begs from you, and from one who takes away your goods, do not demand them back. And as you wish that others would do to you, do so to them. If you love those who love you, what benefit is that to you? For even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good to those who do good to you, what benefit is that to you? For even sinners do the same. And if you lend to those from whom you expect to receive, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners to get back the same amount. But love your enemies and do good and lend, expecting nothing in return, and your reward will be great, and you will be sons of the Most High. For he is kind to the ungrateful and the evil. Be merciful even as your Father is merciful." So here Jesus, he's talking to this group of people, and he's talking about our enemies, and he says to love your enemies. Don't retaliate with your enemies. Don't seek vengeance with your enemies. Don't seek violence with your enemies. But Jesus says to love your enemies. To anybody who opposes your objective, anybody who opposes you, anybody who opposes your will or goal in life, what should we do to them? We should love them. That's what Jesus tells us in Luke 6 on the Sermon on the Mount. He says to love your enemies. And this goes in total contrast with what our society and what our nature tells us to do. And this here, loving your enemies, is so much easier said than done. It's so much easier to say if someone strikes you on the cheek to turn to your other cheek as well. It's so much easier to say that than to actually do that. It's so much easier to say if someone takes your cloak, then offer your tunic as well. Many of you guys may not know what a tunic is. A tunic is a form of undergarment. So that is much easier said than done. If you love those who love you, what good is it? what good is it if you love those who love you? Everybody is doing that. Sinners, everybody in the whole world is loving people who love them back. And so what benefit is that to you? What does that show about you? It doesn't show really much of anything to you. And if you give to those who give to you, that doesn't say anything about you either. Everyone does this. Everyone gives to people who gives to them back. Everyone does these things. You won't stick out at all if all you're doing is loving people who love you and giving people who give back to you. You won't be different from the rest of the world if you do this. But if you want to be different, if you want to be a called out group of people, if you want to be the church, Jesus says in verse 35, but love your enemies and do good and lend expecting nothing in return, and your reward will be great, and you will be sons of the Most High, or daughters of the Most High. For he is kind to the ungrateful and the evil. Be merciful even as your Father is merciful. So in verses 28 through 34, Jesus talking about what everybody does. Everybody is loving on those who love them back, and everybody's giving to those who give back to them. But if you want to be different, if you want to be the church, if you want to be a disciple of Christ, a son or daughter of God, then you better love your enemies. You better do good, and you better lend expecting nothing in return. And again, as I mentioned before, this is so much easier said than done. When someone is opposing what we are doing, when someone is seeking evil and seeking harm for us, it's our human nature, it's our instinct to get back at them, to get even. You know, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. And you know, that was the law that they went by in the Old Testament. An eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But here, Jesus says, love your enemies. Love those who seek to do harm to you. Love those who oppose you and your will. So why should we as Christians love our enemies? And today we're going to be talking about that. And today we're going to talk about two main reasons as to why we should love our enemies. And reason number one is simple, it's obvious, because Christ commands us to. We just got done reading that in Luke chapter 6. Christ commands us to love our enemies. And you guys are all smart cookies. You all know that we should obey our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. When Jesus commands us to do something, when Jesus tells us to do something, you better listen to him. You better obey what he has to say, for he has a lot of power and authority. God has handed all power and all authority over to Jesus. So you better obey the word of Jesus. So that's reason number one. That's pretty straightforward. We just read that. Christ commands us to love our enemies. That should be reason enough. We shouldn't need any other reason to love our enemies than the fact that Jesus commands us to love our enemies. But reason number two that we're going to talk about today and why we should love our enemies is because God loved us first. God loved us first, and we can read about this in the book of Romans. So if you have your Bibles, you can flip just a couple of books after Luke into the book of Romans, Romans chapter 5, and we'll be reading just a couple of verses, verses 8 through 10. Here Paul is writing to the church in Rome, and he is talking about God's love that he demonstrates towards each and every one of us. If I can get there with the wind. It says in verse 8 through 10 of chapter 5, but God shows his love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, you heard that right, while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son. Much more, now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. So it says that God showed his love for us while we were still sinners. While we were enemies of God. That's right. While we were enemies of God, God showed his love for each and every one of us by sending his perfect son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for all of us. Because at one point or another, we were all, by definition, enemies of God. We were all opposing God's will by living a life of sin. When God sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for our sins, mankind was partaking in the worship of foreign gods. Mankind was partaking in sexual immorality. Mankind was partaking in lying and cheating and murder and deception. Just about whatever sin you could possibly imagine, mankind was partaking in. And so by definition, mankind, humans, we were enemies of God. Because we directly oppose God's will to have a perfect relationship with us. That perfect relationship is ruined when we live a life of sin. We learned that from Adam and Eve when they committed the sin in the garden. Their perfect relationship with God was destroyed. And so by definition, if we live a life of sin, we are enemies of God. Now, someone here is going to misunderstand me because you guys may not totally be listening and understanding what I'm having to say. The fact of us being enemies with God at one point in time has nothing to do with what God did, but it has all to do with the sins that we commit. So I hope you guys all hear me straight in that. I hope none of you guys misunderstand me and are too afraid to hear that we at one time were enemies of God. If we are a part of the church, if we are disciples of God, if we are baptized believers, no, we're no longer enemies of God. But before we were baptized believers in God and his son, Jesus Christ, before all of that, God sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for us. While mankind was still his enemies. Because mankind, we humans, were opposing God's will by living a life of sin. And God gave us the ultimate gift of love while we were his enemies. That is awesome. That is a God of love that we worship and serve. That he was willing to give up everything that he had in his perfect son, Jesus, for you and I, for his enemies. Because God loves his enemies. God loves all people of the world. And we should try to reflect that character of God. And we, too, should love our enemies. Even if people are opposing ourselves, we should give them the love that God first gave to us. So when someone directly opposes you, when someone makes themselves an enemy of you, make the choice to give them your love. And chances are you'll probably shock them. They'll probably be off their A game when you choose to give them love when they choose to be your enemy. Now, we live in a society where Christians in general don't have very many enemies because we live in a society where most people are tolerant of our beliefs. Now, the fact is that I could see this changing in the future, and I think it is changing right now. And many Christians would probably think that this is a bad thing, that Christians may find themselves to have more enemies in the near future, but I'm not so sure I would agree with them. In the first 3 centuries after Jesus lived on this earth, Christians had a lot of enemies, and they were heavily persecuted. During this time, the Christians took their faith very seriously. Their lives revolved around their faith in Jesus Christ. A lot of them considered it to be an honor. They considered it to be a privilege, and they hoped to be a martyr for Christ's sake. In other words, they would hope that they would die for their faith in Jesus. I mean, the Christians in the first 3 centuries, they were on fire for God. They were on fire for God while they were being heavily persecuted by the Roman government and all these other people who thought this Christian group were a bunch of wackos, a bunch of weirdos who called each other sisters and brothers. And they ate the Lord's Supper, they ate the body and drank the blood. They thought the Christians were a bunch of weirdos that they persecuted. And during this time, during the time when the Christians had a lot of enemies, they were on fire for God. And then in 313 AD, nearly 300 years after Jesus lived, Constantine, the emperor of Rome, and his rival brother-in-law Licinius signed the Edict of Milan, which allowed Christians and all other faiths to follow the mode of religion which to each of them appeared best. And so all of a sudden in the year 313, all of a sudden, for the most part, persecution of Christians was ended, for the most part. And Constantine even favored the Christians over other religions. And so that made the lives of Christians even easier. Their enemies were disappearing right before their eyes. Then in 380 AD, nearly 70 years later, the Emperor Theodosius made Christianity the official religion of the Roman Empire. Now, rather than being persecuted for their faith, they maintained a high status in their society for being a Christian. So Christianity got so easy, it became so easy to be a Christian. And these Christians were just able to blend in with the rest of the society. And Christians, because of that, they had a change in the sincerity of their faith. We see that no longer, for the most part, Christians were no longer on fire for God. No longer did their lives revolve around their faith in Jesus. Now their faith in Jesus and his Father, our Heavenly Father Yahweh, it was just another aspect of their life. It's just another part of who they were. It wasn't who they were, it was just another part of who they were. And I find that to be the truth as well. Here in America, Christians don't really have many enemies. Much like the Christians after 380 AD, we don't have many enemies. And in fact, a lot of people in our society, a lot of people here in Clark County, they probably identify themselves as someone who believes in God. And you know, that requires us to not stick out too much. You know, we can kind of blend in with the society, and that's dangerous. That's dangerous. That can have a lot of negative effects on our lives and our walk with God. It can encourage us and invoke us to live a lukewarm life, a lukewarm faith for God and his Son, Jesus Christ. And so, yeah, it's great that we can live in peace and we don't have to fear our lives because of the faith that we have. But I think because of that, because of the fact that Christians, for the most part in America, don't have many enemies, I think that encourages us to live a lazy Christian life. I think that encourages us to just identify ourselves as just a part of Christianity. That's just a part of who we are. That's not who we are. It's just a part of who we are. And I think the effects are devastating. And so I think this could all change soon, though, as I mentioned earlier. This world that we live in is nasty. There's a lot of evil people in this world out there. A lot of them. People are committing evil things and are being justified to do so. Lots of actions that aren't biblical at all, that go directly contrary to how we are to treat one another. If someone offends or makes themselves an enemy, people retaliate with violence and verbally attack them. And let me tell you, this is not what we are called to do as Christians. I'm not going to get into the politics of everything that's going on and all the rioting and so forth. I'm not going to do that. But I will say that the violence taking place, it's not okay. Biblically speaking, it is not okay. Because we as Christians, we are to love our enemies. We are to love our enemies and do good to them. And so all the craziness in our society, all the violence acts being justified, this is serving as a perfect opportunity for us Christians. This is serving as a perfect opportunity for us Christians to be the light of the world, to stick out and no longer blend in with society, because I think day in and day out, as we're speaking right now, our world is falling further and further away from God. And this serves as a perfect opportunity for us, the church, to be the light of the world. When you bring a flashlight out in the middle of the day, it doesn't shine very bright, does it? Because the whole world is bright. But when we're living in a world of darkness, we can illuminate the world. We can shine ever so bright. And so don't be influenced by the violence taking place in our world. Don't be influenced by the evil people in our world. But instead, choose to be different. Choose to love your enemies. Because day by day, that's becoming more and more of an unusual thing, to love your enemies. And it's providing us Christians the perfect opportunity to be a light to the world by loving our enemies. And we're to love our enemies, one, because Christ commands us to. That should be reason enough. Christ commands us to love our enemies. But also, number two, God loved us first while we were still his enemies. And we should try and reflect God's character unto the people we come into contact, the people who are our enemies, people who oppose us as Christians. And we have a perfect opportunity before each and every one of us. It's something to get excited about. So when you're confronted by someone who chooses to be your enemy, choose to give them your love. Choose to give them your love because Christ commanded it and God loved you while you were his enemy. And so let's kill our enemies with kindness. Let's kill them with kindness and show them our love. Love your enemies. Let's pray. Father God, I just thank you for this day. Father, thank you for the love that you showed us while we were living a life of sin. Father, I thank you for that beautiful gift of love where we can be your children, where we can be sons and daughters of the Most High God. And Father, I just pray that we can be encouraged and influenced by the love that you share to us, and that we can choose to give our love to you, Father, to give love to our enemies. And Father, I just thank you so much for this opportunity to be a light to the world, to be different from the world, and we can show what our faith in your Son affects our lives. And God, I just pray that we all today, we can take this lesson of loving our enemies and we can apply it in our lives so that we could be different from the world and we can make a difference in this world by the love we give to our enemies. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Chapter 4, verse 19 says, "We love because he first loved us." We learn how to love by watching him, by seeing how he has loved us, and that's how we learn how to love other people. So we're going to close out by singing Reckless Love, a song all about how God has loved us with abandon, with passion, and in a way that the world doesn't always recognize.
Chases me down, fights till I
We're all going to be confronted by enemies in our day-to-day lives, and we all have to make the difficult choice to choose to love our enemies, because Christ commanded us to love our enemies, and as this song just sang, while we were still God's foes, He gave His life for us. He gave His love for us by sending His Son for us. And so thank you. I hope you all have a great rest of your week, and I hope you all choose to give everyone your love. Thank you, and have a good week.